It's a great pleasure to introduce our next speaker, Dr. Surajit Chaudhuri, who's the Research Area Manager for Data Management Area at Microsoft Research Redmond. Surajit is a leader in the area of database research, particularly on self-tuning database systems, query optimization, and data cleaning. His work has been very influential both in the research community in terms of publication and awards. Like, he's won the ACM Sigmod Contribution Award and the Test of Time Award from VLDB. But also internally at Microsoft, he has had a lot of impact on Microsoft's flagship database product, SQL Server, and a bunch of other products. Today he's going to be talking about new ways of looking at managing structured data.
Good afternoon. Venkat, thanks very much for the kind introduction. It's my pleasure to talk to all of you. However, I think this is the first and the last time I'll be going after a speaker who shows audio and video and graphics and images. I haven't done this ever, and now I'm convinced I should never do it again. My slides are very bland, some stolen, but I hope that I'm here to communicate to you that although database field is now, you know, more than 30 years old, even relational databases, there are a lot of exciting changes, and the field is going through, in fact, a period in which a lot more changes are probably anticipated than in the last decade. The three factors that I decided to focus the talk on, three factors, and together think about what impact they would have. The first one is hardware. The changes on the hardware that has taken place over now, the last several decades have actually significantly have the potential to change the way we build or think about DBMSs in the future. The text and structured data has had a significant change in our IT landscape in terms of search and advertising. And finally, the cost of ownership is going through some dramatic changes and our quest for doing cloud services and other ways to minimize cost. So I would have the discussions around these three topics and try to engage you in the discussions maybe afterwards to see what you think. So if you think about the relational databases, the basic relational database architecture hasn't really changed over the decades. But if you look carefully on what are the characteristics of memory, CPU, and disks, this is what it was, let's say, in the 80s when the relational databases came into existence. And then when you think about what is happening now, you can see how dramatically they are different. What is also important to note that the changes are not exactly by the same multipliers. And what we'll see that these differences, that where you see the disk capacity has increased very significantly, compared to probably the memory bandwidth and other stuff, would have significant impact on how the new architecture should be. So the main question for us is the architecture that we had in the 80s still functional, still the best way to think about relational databases? And the answer is probably not, for two key reasons. There is now a much significant imbalance between the disk capacities and transfer rates, or the relative ratios that existed in the 1980s and now. And secondly, the CPU performance in the main memory bandwidth is also out of whack compared to then. So we have incredibly inexpensive disks. We all have like terabytes of data in our homes these days. And I remember that when, in terms of even structured data that are easily in terabytes and multi-terabytes in many organizations and petabytes. And when I was in school, the poster child for the data warehousing project used to be Walmart, and it had 4 gigabytes of data, structured data. Very valuable, but we have gone through a dramatic change in the storage technologies and our data collection, and inexpensive disk has sort of led that. Surprisingly, though, compared to the capacity, our the transfer rates have not really gone up nearly by the same factor. And this picture sort of, which was there in the previous picture as well, underscores that point. The capacity has gone out by 10,000 times, and the transfer rates have gone up only by 65 times. What it means is that if you look at the metric, which is the transfer bandwidth per byte, the disk has actually become a lot slower. This was the ratio in 1980, and 2009, the ratios are dramatically different. So if you, in effect, although it sounds like we have a lot of capacity, we really don't have the ability to look at that, you know, all of that, and we can only look at a small part, and we have to be really careful about that. The same point is essentially, another way to state the same point is, the sequential access versus random access, you know, their effect is dramatically different these days. In 1980, these are the sort of the numbers you had, you know, 30 random IOs per second at 8 kilobyte pages, it comes out to about 240 KB per second. And so, and when you do the numbers, the sequential is to random ratio is about 5:1. You know, that was the sort of the difference in your access. In 2009, the same ratio sort of stands at 33:1. So the sequential access is a way much more attractive compared to the random access. So anytime you're doing random access is really, really bad. So if you look at, this is the first factor we sort of talked about, which is the imbalance between the disk capacities and the transfer rates. Let's look very briefly on the second factor, which is the gap between CPU performance and main memory. So in 1980, so this was sort of the numbers we had in terms of the L1 cache and the number of cycles it took to, you know, 10 cycles per instructions, and for the memory, 6 cycles to about access the main memory. This is where roughly the numbers stand now for L1 cache, L2 cache. And the key, you know, if you look to the numbers, what would strike you very significantly is the last one, you're spending about 200 cycles to access memory. So in other words, if you have to go to main memory, you're paying a very severe penalty. And you have to, in some ways, do everything to avoid that or to get the cache, having avoid from having too much of cache misses. So and this is sort of summarized. I'm sorry that it is not very clearly visible, but the point really is that memory access are much slower. So this is obviously a big point, and the database systems have tried to, you know, look at this issue. And one of the most dramatic point came here is, I think it was about a couple of years ago, suddenly there was a new set of database vendors who published a bunch of results in data warehousing space which blew the traditional vendors away. Of course, you know, there are many trade-offs, but the numbers initially came very surprising. And they were recognizing these trends, and they didn't have the legacy of the past, which allowed them to essentially deal with such situations better, because they're building a server from scratch. So let me just give you some examples of the approaches that that were undertaken. One was that just optimize for sequential access, do not have redundant structures such as indexes and material as you accept in a very, very simple and rudimentary form, have a lot of partitions, and then scan those partitions sequentially. So the idea is that you have very simple partitioning, don't make that complex enough that you have to go through a lot of indexing and maintenance problem, very simple scans, partitions. Some of the other vendors, such as Netezza, went a little further. They said, well, you know, we can use some FPGA for efficient projection and selection. So they will essentially have this very close to the disk, effectively as disk controllers, and stream the data through and essentially get as little data upstream as possible. So you want to use sequential scan, and you want to make sure less and less data sort of travel upstream. So this is sort of their, you know, architecture, although now they work also on commodity boxes. They have a lot of this, you know, shared nothing architecture with the snippet processing units, which are essentially your blade architecture. You can stick in another extra blade if you need more ability to do so. And they have very, you know, very quick way to support the database operations right near the disk, sort of like the active disk concept that we had talked about in research before. The other observation was that typically when, you know, when we started the relational databases, we were always trying to make sure that we can support the OLTP applications well, and those were really important. So sort of our layout has traditionally been in a row. This is, of course, not very strictly true. There were systems like Sybase IQ, which were probably one of the, also noted that instead of storing the thing in rows, if you store things in a column format, there are some benefits. And why is that? First of all, in a data warehousing space, when you are essentially trying to answer a decision support queries, you have many attributes of data recorded. But at any one time, you're asking for only a few of those attributes. So you don't want to, you know, have it laid out in such a way so that you get all of these bytes unnecessarily. It's much better to have it vertically. This is one reason. The second reason is it turns out when you do store it this way, you have a tremendous opportunity to compress data. You can use something like run length encoding and very simple techniques to get a lot of data which, you know, to eliminate and compress it and use your CPU cycles, which are relatively, you know, as I discussed in the architecture, are not that much in demand compared to all the memory bandwidth and the disk transfer issues. So utilize the CPU, you can, you know, uncompress it and essentially have the ability to deal with this hardware shift. Notice here that one of the things these databases did, which are popularly known revived by a company called Vertica and now used by many other vendors, they sort of said the question that you don't have to do an explicit join when you reconstruct the row. So you can, what you do for each row, you can just store it in exactly, you know, without the row ID, sort of stream it out and you join them at the same time. And yet you can compress each of the columns. And that really helps. So these are some of the, so I sort of highlighted at a very high level the two techniques. There are also cache-conscious algorithms which are very, very useful in these scenarios. So this is one main thread, which is the hardware characteristics, how they have an impact on, you know, some of our engines. And, you know, for the vendors such as Microsoft, Oracle, IBM, and, you know, who have an engine for many years, it turns out that while they could be disruptive, there are also ways to mitigate some of the risks by thinking of them as access methods without disrupting the entire architecture. It's a longer discussion, but these characteristics are beginning to have impact on how we think about the DBMS server architecture. Text and structured data. So with that, I'm going to transition into the second factor that I wanted to discuss with you, which is text and structured data. So what a couple of decades ago, a very well-known researcher told me, you know, in the text also we have a lots of data, like you database people, but your data is the only valuable data. Our data is there, but, you know, nobody really cares about that data. And it was true. But this is no longer true. You know, the search and the advertising, that the web search and the advertising that goes with it has now a lot of dollars. And, you know, that actually had two impacts. The popularity of search led to two very different things. One is that the search box suddenly is a very popular querying paradigm, no matter what you are searching. Even, you know, our mindset today is that even if I'm going against a data which is in a database, yeah, why not? It makes sense to search even business objects using, you know, simple search box querying model. And we are beginning to see applications more and more which use both the structured data and text. And this wasn't true two decades ago. There was a little bit of data maybe in the database server, which we sort of use a full text engine that all database vendors had, but now we are seeing at a completely different level. The second is, in order to do the search business well, the web search companies had to do a lot of text analytics, discover a lot of patterns, analyze the patterns, count things at a very large, at a web scale. And that meant that they needed to harness parallelism. Turns out, for their needs, the SQL wasn't sufficiently flexible, and that led to other interesting developments for the evolution of the platform. So I'll come to that in a second. Let's start with the impact of the very first factor. So this is how the world sort of stood, that you have querying and content, if you think of them as two axes. Traditionally, the structured database, the SQL was a structured query language working on structured data. The top corner on the, right. And in the bottom left is keyword queries over text data. And these two are well-established worlds. And with the popularity of the search box, the one on the top left became particularly interesting. And the couple of applications I just want to highlight there on why they are important. So let's start with the one that you are all familiar with. So when you go to this structured store, you are essentially going to these popular stores. You are essentially going against a structured database. But yet, when you ask the query, you are just using the standard, you know, the search box paradigm of looking up the information, which is very structured. So you are going to ask for a query such as give canon rebel XTI, you're looking for a camera and you just give, you know, part of the name, and you expect from the database of the various products, the right database should pop up and you know, be returned to in a ranked order. Now, when you, this particular functionality goes beyond just the vertical search, product search. When you ask a query, increasingly you see the structured results being mixed. So, in effect, if I recognize that you have asked the same Canon Revel XTI in a regular web search box, the systems are smart enough to federate it, go to the structure store at the back end, shoot this query, get the result, and intermix it with the other documents' results and return to you. What's effectively, in the back end, there is a structured database that is being accessed. But there is something interesting going on just other than just going and accessing a structured store. This information about when you talk about Canon Revel XTI, in order to answer this kind of keyword search, the data which is locked, if you will, in the list of structured products and their attributes, it is sort of, if you will, effectively crawled out of the database and indexed in an IR engine. So, you know, we are the structured data people, but here are the structured database which is being, you know, crawled and is being indexed outside by an IR engine. And then when you have a good hit on that index, instead of just returning a document, you actually have a virtual document, which is you execute a query against a structured data backend and pull out the particular product description, like whatever is the Canon Revel XTI hit. So here are the two engines working side by side, both important, and yet we have never seen, perhaps 2 decades ago, these two engines having to work, you know, at scale in this way. In addition to this, there are some unique challenges that come because the way we think about web search and, you know, where we expect that we can give an approximate string and, yeah, you know, because of the statistical redundancy, you know, we get the right hits. But that's not quite true in the world of products. And what it means is that there are a lot of data cleaning, approximate string matching technology that you need to bring to bear to be able to answer a query such as Canon Revel XTI. Most likely, it is not the case that in the database, the description is stored exactly using those two strings. It is not even the case if you just were to go ahead and use a standard edit distance or standard text-based distance metrics that you'll get a good hit. So it's actually a very interesting problem, and we have done some work in this, how to deal with imprecise query, how to do entity match, how to bring the knowledge that's actually in the document along with what is in the structured data. And it's not just us, you know, other web search companies are also doing that, and this is a very interesting space where these two engines are working together, being aware of each other's content. So this issue of these two engines working together is not necessarily limited to just web. You know, the enterprise search, which essentially takes the point of view that you're asking again this search query over all your enterprise assets. And that could include just vanilla websites, SharePoint, files, and structured data. And architecturally, what it does, you have an adapter, if you will, for each of these sources. And the idea is to support the search paradigm over this using this kind of an adapter model. And so just wanted to highlight these two engines working together, you know, has other important applications such as enterprise search. And it's a fascinating subject. I'd love to talk to you over the break. Let me, so this is the slide you saw earlier, highlighting the two ways the search and ad has influenced, you know, the way we think about data in a structured database, at least in the web search and product search context. Let me turn on the platform piece, which is just the fact that text had to do a lot of analytics to support effectively the search, identify the features that are effective, needed to look at their document data and be able to do analytics at scale. And when you think of doing anything in scale, the only thing we knew 2 decades ago to do in a completely automated way, data parallelism, was SQL. SQL was a programming paradigm which allowed you to harness data parallelism rather easily using a high-level programming language. And then you get an automatic parallelism via data partitioning. The parallel DBMS systems supported the ability to do this at reasonable scale. But one of the things that a couple of areas in which the relational databases had weaknesses are, for example, our programming model, when we wanted very high degree of flexibility, was sort of not so ideal. We had to go down and write it in a completely UDF language. So think about something like a page rank. If you want to write that, it would be, you can, yes, write this as a giant UDF, but then you have not really used, you have not used the parallelism quite as effectively. Excuse me. And if you have more complex things such as generating a collection of inverted index files using some custom compression, these are harder programs to write just using the UDF. In fact, the programs would then look like just nothing but the UDF, then you are not harnessing most of the power of SQL. So when programmer flexibility is important, you know, you can argue that SQL database systems were not necessarily the best thing unless it very well mapped with your, you know, the architecture of data warehousing queries that we are so familiar with. The other aspect is when you do things at scale, there will be failures. And if you want to recover from these failures, you want the unit of failure to be small. And in case of SQL, when you want to do that, you effectively would have a unit which is really that of at the level of querying. And if you want final level, then SQL had some shortcomings. So, and materialization data load is another aspect where you must first suck the data into SQL before you can analyze it. So this led to, I think many of you are familiar with this MapReduce programming model, and I don't want to go into the details. This was, you know, the foundations were in functional programming, popularized by Google and now adopted, you know, almost all web search companies, you know, Yahoo, Microsoft, they have their implementations. And in terms of technology, Dryad and other such technology have pushed this further beyond MapReduce. But at a super high level, you know, it allows you to take a function, you know, with a key and a payload sort of model, take that, you know, give it to a number of workers, you know, split on that key, and then each worker can go ahead and work on their particular input files, produce a result of a new key and an intermediate values, reduce, sort of takes that list and merge and sort of works on it and produces one or a smaller list. So that's the overall model. So one is the programming model, which allows you to think much more flexibly compared to SQL. The other aspect is not just the programming model. It is also the fact there is a distributed systems and the ability to recover from faults and, you know, how you restart the processes, which give it its teeth. So this is sort of how you do that, you know, how you have to think in terms of page rank, in terms of map and reduce steps. I'll skip over that. So if you look at this as a lightweight of parallelism, the main advantage, it essentially says, it is very friendly to procedural languages. It doesn't require back-end databases. You know, you essentially get, you know, the fine-grained fault tolerance, the topic that we sort of discussed. One of the things, of course, it does in the process, it actually materializes. And because it materializes, which gives us the ability to also recover from faults, but in terms of query performance, it can suffer. So if you just have a lot of BI queries you are running over, you know, after you have loaded the data, you know, the database systems are obviously going to be more efficient in those cases. And again, one thing to keep in mind when you think about these two contrasting architecture, not everybody has a web-scale data. And that really has a big impact on how you choose the particular architecture. But nonetheless, the fact remains that for the first time, compared to two decades ago, we have another, if you will, infrastructure or a framework which gives you auto-parallelism. And when you think about it, this particular aspect goes far beyond just thinking in terms of it was for text analytics. Now, for the first time, you have some thinking to do on what should be your architecture. Should you build a SQL layer on top of MapReduce? People are actually doing that in various places. Because by going that higher level of abstraction, you get the programming ease and a lot of other support, automatic data distribution, optimization. So people are sort of building it on top of MapReduce. Conversely, MapReduce invoking SQL as one of the provider, for example, you know, or a storage engine such as, you know, Bigtable, accessing is the other way you can think about the architecture, or SQL invoking MapReduce, where MapReduce, if you will, is sort of the UDF model. So there are various ways, you know, people are thinking about it. It's still a very early days to see what architecture will give, but it certainly is the case that the arrival of MapReduce has an impact on the way we think about data analysis at large. In the sense, your virtualization can be either local on your local data center or a cloud-based service. And the only point I want to make, because I don't want to go into a lot of details here, is that database systems sort of takes over the resource management part and sort of fights with the operating system to take that over. So when you have a VM situation, you have to think a little bit harder about how does it interact with the database resource management thing. So it's an interesting problem to think about in a research sense on how the database resource management interacts with the virtualization. So this is one way you can, people have thought about how to reduce the cost. The second way is thinking about database as an appliance. So I sort of showed you this Netezza, so which sort of uses the sequential scans and partitions and FPGA very effectively. But one of their other value proposition is, look, we have actually integrated the stack very carefully. So you give us a call if your so-called DBMS appliance is not working, and we actually, you know, have a vertical stack so that it serves you very well. So this is another way we have seen in the evolution in the database field, which has gone and essentially says, let's use the appliance-based model. And finally, the so-called infrastructure or cloud services, where the basic value proposition is an on-demand provisioning. If you need resources for more data, doing the more databases, sure, we'll give you the storage, you get the network, you get the CPUs, and you pay as you go model. This, however, so the next two slides have nothing to do with DBMSs. And this is, you know, two slides borrowed from Chapel. But I think this is a very, very important thing, which may be obvious to many of you, but it's really important to point out. So there are really, this is a nice way, that's why I like the Chapel's taxonomy, which is to say that, you know, there is one category which is software as a service. So if you think about Salesforce.com, Salesforce.com is a web service. You go and you can upload and analyze your sales data. At the back end, I can't tell now, but at least initially it was built using, you know, SMP boxes. And, you know, so the back end was quote-unquote traditional. And what it means is that this is a web-facing service, gave you great value in terms of being able to use it over the web service model, but it was a very traditional architecture. It had nothing to do with the infrastructure play. The second is, which is in the middle, I want to talk about it. It's a little bit like you have a client component, and then you have, you know, an attached service like what you see with iTunes and so on. And then finally on the right is really the thing we are talking about in the last slide, which is you have an application and it taps into the cloud more as an infrastructure piece. So the cloud sort of provides the platform, and in that model what you have is that the cloud application could, you can't see the arrows very clearly, but you can build a application either cloud-based or on-premise, which can access the cloud infrastructure services. For example, you're building a database app, it goes and accesses the storage and the QP functionality on the cloud. So what most lately has happened, beyond, you know, as many of you are aware, is that, you know, both Amazon and Microsoft at least have database as a service. So this is, for example, an architecture of SQL Azure, and I won't go through it. It's built using SQL Server as a main building block. So as a developer of application, your model is you're essentially going and programming a SQL box. And the provisioning of it is done by the system. You know, the manageability in terms of the hardware layer is done by the system. You are still responsible for the performance tuning on your box. But your programming model is that as if you're using a SQL Server box. Just as in case of relational, the same thing is true for Amazon. Relational data services, RDS, their abstraction is they're using a MySQL. So in both cases, the provisioning and backup is by the provider, but there is no distributed transactions and other support. But there's still early days, this will probably come. But you can contrast this with a provider such as Amazon SimpleDB. In that case, what was happening is you just had an abstraction, it's a key value store. And automatically at the back end, it sort of expands and you have it geo-replicated and the right indexing gets done. This is the relational data services is a different model, which is a full fidelity relational model where you are in charge of your database system, but the provisioning and everything is done remotely. There are a lot of open questions here and a lot of research questions which are wide open on transactional model. When you think about a BI kind of scenario, there are two questions that are in this world is obvious. If indeed you are going to have everything coming from the cloud, supporting the cloud, how are you going to deal with the data load issues? So not surprisingly, for example, Amazon has a data import service where you can essentially send them, if you will, a media, and that they will load up. As Jim Gray used to say, if you want to get a lot of data somewhere, you basically, you know, send it by FedEx. And essentially, that's a big problem. And then you have to think about long-running BI queries. A query is going on for a long time. How do you administer it? How do you abort it? And how you deal with it? And these are all very, very hard problems and is worth thinking about. And if you are going to effectively support cloud infrastructure services, this is super important. Compared to software as service, such as Salesforce.com, multi-tenancy is a very different problem here. There, everybody had the same schema. There was an application which shared a lot of commonality. This is no longer true in this world. You can start using, you know, the SQL Azure service with your own database, your own schema, which has nothing to do with my database, my schema, my workload. How effectively can you take advantage of the commonality? How do you leverage it for the provisioning? And these are again, very open questions and fertile grounds for much more thinking. So I sort of gone through these three factors. I wanted to say that these are not the only, I just picked them because these are, you know, in 30 minutes, I can only probably talk three and I'm sort of out of time. There are a lot of interesting other problems that in the last decade have really influenced our field in the area of BI, the data quality and the extract, transform and load, streaming data engines, the real-time BI where the business decisions in many cases are shrinking, where you want a real-time response to the BI kind of queries. And last and not but the least, the development of Link or language integrated querying, I think, is a huge step forward. We have always struggled with, you know, impedance mismatch in databases between procedural and the, you know, our SQL-based language. I think Link provides an extremely elegant solution to that problem, and it's worth thinking about. So I talked about the database system as a field about mostly around three factors. I just wanted to sort of end with just, I don't get this audience every day, so I thought I'll just let you know the kind of stuff we are working at Redmond Lab. So we are working a lot on data quality issues with scalable algorithms on web as well as enterprise data. Some of our work from data quality and data cleaning is in the both Bing Shopping, Bing Maps, and SQL Server. I talked about web data mining, where the web and you use the documents as well as the, what information you have in the products together, and that's something we are working on in discovering the relationships. And finally, we are beginning to look at, when you talk about complex decision support queries on a cloud infrastructure, how do you think about its manageability? Other dream I have, which is my personal thing, that there are a lot of open database problems, such as think about query optimization and very old classical problems, for which we have great opportunity to rethink. And those remains one of my quests. So with that, thank you very much for listening.